All right. So this is joint work with people from IBM Research and ETH Zurich. And I mean, given the title of the workshop, I don't think anyone would be surprised if I say traditional hardware designs have reached their limits and applications that require improved performance turn to specialized hardware. And a notable example of an application domain that does this is neural networks. Neural networks are very widely used, which creates a strong incentive for people to actually try and improve the performance. And they are also specialized computations expressed as data flow graphs, which is a really good form to be mapped into specialized hardware. And indeed, there are many attempts to accelerate the performance using GPUs, ASICs, or FPGAs. And in our work, we are trying to do that, accelerate neural network computations using computational memory. So the idea behind computational memory is to exploit the physical attributes of memory devices to perform computations at the place where data are stored. So this is in contrast with traditional designs where you have different units for computations and memory. Specifically, the hardware unit that we are considering in this work is a computational memory crossbar. This memristive array can store a matrix and at the same time can perform an analog matrix vector multiplication if we feed it the proper input. So if we feed it a vector, the output that will give us is the multiplication of the matrix which is stored in the crossbar with this vector. Now, I'm oversimplifying things here. There are many trade-offs and many details that hardware designers do in order to achieve this, but this is the main premise. And so the benefits of doing so is that the operation, the multiplication, can be executed in a single step, while typically this requires multiple steps in digital logic. And at the same time, this has reduced communication. Because the matrix already exists, it's embedded into the crossbar, there's no need to fetch the matrix data. And communication is the main challenge for these data intensive workloads like neural networks. So we are building a computational memory accelerator that comprises multiple cores with such crossbars. So what about software? Can we use the existing software stack for driving this accelerator? Not so much. The reason is that traditional accelerators use data parallelism. And so to give you a very simple example, if you have a neural network with just two layers and you want to map this on a two-core accelerator, the data parallel execution will split the input and then execute the first layer on two cores, get the results, and then execute the code for the second layer on these results. And this is basically the standard one layer at a time that most of traditional accelerators use. Now, this will not work for the computational memory accelerator, and the reason is that because the technology that we use is PCM, or it can also be flash, reprogramming the crossbar takes far too long for this approach to make sense, even if we use batching. So reprogramming a crossbar might take 1 minute or even longer. So this approach, the data parallel approach, is not suitable for the computational memory accelerator. Instead, what we want to use is pipeline parallelism. So in this case, basically we are mapping the data flow graph of the neural network into the accelerator and then execute for the first chunk of data on step one and for the second chunk of data on step two. And the functions that run in the cores, in this case, do not change, which means that the matrix of the crossbar remains the same, so we don't have to reprogram the crossbars. Now, the problem is that existing compilers, such as Glow, TVM, or even XLA, they do not offer help for dealing with this pipeline parallelism. So we need to rethink the software stack if we want to drive this type of accelerators. So the goal of this work is basically to explore how can we build a software stack for such a computational memory accelerator that targets neural networks. And the approach that we follow is that we co-design the software with the hardware. So in the rest of the talk, I'm going to talk about what the hardware looks like, which is basically a chip comprising multiple cores, each including a crossbar, and it is explicitly programmed as a data flow engine. And I will also talk about the software. I will talk about the software architecture for the compiler, and I will mention some details about a particular challenging problem that we faced when we tried to build the software stack. And this problem is, how can we deal with the dependency control between the cores? How can we implement this logic? Just to specify the scope of this particular work, we are looking into convolutional neural networks specifically, and we are also targeting inference, and specifically on the edge. So this is what the computational memory accelerator looks like. It has a bunch of cores which are interconnected via a network. It has some chip memory, and it also has a control unit, which we'll call the global control unit, which basically orchestrates data transfers between external memory, for example, host memory, and chip memory, as well as chip memory and the different cores that will do the computation. Now, looking closer at one computational memory core, as I said, it has an analog crossbar for performing the matrix vector multiplication operation. This crossbar has digital to analog converters on the input and analog to digital converters for the output. There is also a digital processing unit, and the purpose of this unit is to execute things that we cannot execute on the crossbar. An example would be doing the activation functions such as ReLU of a neural network. There is also some local memory, typically SRAM, and there is also a control unit which basically controls the execution of a single core. And just to give you an idea how the whole thing works, the control unit will start the computation by transferring the appropriate data from memory to the crossbar and initiate the crossbar analog operation. Once the operation is done, the results will be available for the digital unit, and this will pretty much act as a standard core. It will do computations and it can load and store data to local memory. And also it can schedule transfers from the local memory to other cores via the interconnect. Now, when this happens, when data from the interconnect arrive at the local memory of a core, the addresses that were written act as input for the control unit state machine, and depending on the data that are there, it might trigger the next operation, and so on and so forth. So to execute convolutions on this accelerator, we basically map the convolution operation to the matrix vector operation. And indeed, the convolution operation is by far the most expensive one computationally in these types of networks. Everything else, as I mentioned already, are executed on the digital processing unit. And the different layers of the network are assigned to different cores, basically forming a pipeline. So for example, if you have, again, this very simple neural network with two convolutions and one addition, then the first convolution will be executed on the crossbar of the first core, the second convolution on the crossbar of the second core, and the addition from the residual path would be executed on the digital unit. And the gray areas are basically how we partition the data flow graph to be executed on the different cores of the accelerator. So the compilation process takes as input a neural network model. This will typically be in ONNX format, which is two things. It's the data flow graph of the operators that constitute the neural network. And it's also the values for the weights, because again, we're doing inference. So we already have the weights, we don't have to train them, and these are part of the model. The output will be the configuration for the control units, the instruction for the digital units, and also we will need to configure the crossbars, typically based on the values of the weights. So compilation happens in two phases. The first one is where we partition the data flow graph and map each partition to a computational memory core. The kind of tricky thing, or one of the tricky things here, is that we have to respect the interconnect constraints. So if two partitions that communicate with each other are mapped to two different cores, these cores must have an edge on the interconnect topology so that they are able to communicate. After we've done that, the second phase is what we call lowering. So basically, for each partition, we produce the corresponding configurations for the control units and the digital units. Now, the configuration for the digital unit is basically a set of instructions, and for the control unit is a state machine. Now, a big part of the state machine is to enforce the dependencies between the cores. And this figure shows an example of one convolution executed on one core and another convolution executed on another core. And the first convolution's output is the input for the second convolution. And obviously there is a dependency here, because the first convolution will write what the second convolution will read. And we need to have specific logic in the control unit so that the computation will only proceed when their dependencies are met. And in this particular example, we have to wait until the first three values are written from core one before we can continue. And this state machine, this logic, is implemented in the local control unit, which basically snoops remote writes from the other cores and then triggers local computations by loading the necessary data to the crossbar. And one of the challenging things that we encountered when building the software stack was, how do we actually configure this control unit? And in order to configure it for the generic case, we need to have somehow a model for the dependence of the computations. We need to be able to reason about the dependencies. And in order to do that, we're using the polyhedral model, which is a standard way for compilers to reason about dependencies. The polyhedral model allows to reason about nested loops that access multidimensional arrays. So this is a really good match for neural network operations. And specifically, we're using the ISL library, which represents computations as Presbyger sets and relations. So I will not go into detail, but this kind of framework and library gives us the opportunity to express dependencies of one computation to a specific memory object array. And using that, we can, and also the algebra provided by the library, we can actually compute a relation that maps observed writes in our memory to the maximum iteration that that our computation can execute. And once we have this relation, we can actually generate code for the control state machine that will make sure that the proper dependencies are enforced. Again, this is a very high level overview. So for details, please check our paper. We also have our implementation online on GitHub. And obviously, you can also ask me either on Slack or by email. So to conclude, I gave you kind of a brief idea of the first step towards compiling neural networks for a computational memory accelerator. I briefly spoke about the software and the hardware architecture, and I touched on how can we actually track dependencies using polyhedral compilation. I have to say this is still very early work, and there are a lot of things that we need to do, but this is just the first step. So at this point, I think we can start asking the question, okay, what is the proper hardware-software interface? What happens if the neural network does not fit the accelerator? How do we deal with challenges like quantization and also with operations that cannot be fitted into a single core? As I mentioned, the code for this work you can find on GitHub. And at this point, I would like to thank you, and I'll be happy to ask, I'll be happy to answer any questions either online or offline. So thank you.
Thank you.